flight number.
Quicker.
We made it!
Yeah!
He is arguably the most famous person in history. Over 2 billion people claim to follow him. That's 1/3 of the world's population. He's represented in art and literature more than any other figure. Time magazine called him the most influential person who has ever lived. But who is Jesus?
Who is Jesus?
I
believe he was a person.
He's the Son of God.
I don't believe Jesus ever really existed.
Son of God.
If I have to answer that question, I would say God.
He plays on the wing for Chelsea.
If you read the Bible, I don't think I believe in all of that.
Everything. You can be any, but for me, he's everything.
Who is Jesus? To be honest with you, I don't know. I'm not super religious or anything, so. I mean, I guess he's a savior or something.
Personally, I think that Jesus was probably a really cool dude who lived a long time ago and gave great advice to people, and it snowballed from there.
For much of my life, I wasn't a Christian. I come from a family of trial lawyers, barristers. My father was a barrister, my mother was a barrister, my sister is a barrister. My son qualified as a barrister. My daughter qualified as a barrister. Both my grandfathers on both sides were barristers. My uncle was a barrister. If we'd had a cat, it would definitely have been a barrister. My father was a Jew, a secular Jew. He'd escaped the Holocaust. Many of his family had died in the Holocaust. My mother was not a churchgoer. My father described himself as an agnostic. And I came to the conclusion that I was an atheist as a teenager, and I was quite an argumentative atheist. Not that I was out to convert people to atheism, but if anyone tried to convert me to Christianity, then I had a lot to say on the subject. And I was quite suspicious of Christians. I'd come across one or two of them in my gap year, and they had these smiles, which I found deeply suspicious. And my first year at university, I had room next door to my great friend, Nicky Lee. And I warned him against these Christians. I said, don't let them into your room, whatever you do. But it was too late. He'd met some, and one time he and his then girlfriend, now his wife, Scylla, came back and they said that they had become Christians. I was horrified. I mean, they were such lovely people. I thought, how can I help them? I really didn't know anything about it, so I thought, I better investigate. So I managed to find this old Bible. And that night I started reading it. I started beginning of the New Testament. I read Matthew's Gospel, Mark, Luke. I got about halfway through John's Gospel, about 3 a.m. I fell asleep. Following day I carried on reading. All that day, all the next day, all the day afterwards. I was a student, so I didn't have any work to do. And when I got to the end of the New Testament, I came to the conclusion, it's true. You can't prove Christianity mathematically. You can't prove it scientifically. Science is obviously very important, but science answers a different set of questions. Science answers the questions, when and how did this world come into being? But it can't answer the question, who and why? Supposing I had a cake here, which I've made, and I give it to a scientist. The scientist will be able to answer the question, how it was made. They may be able to tell you when it was made, but only I can tell you who made it and why I made it. Only the creator of the cake can do that. Only I can tell you I made that cake, and I can tell you why I made that cake. And it's the same with this universe. Only the creator can reveal who made this world and why he made it. And the claim of Christianity is that he has done that. The Creator has revealed himself. And he's revealed himself in the person of Jesus. And the evidence is not scientific evidence. That's not the only kind of evidence, but historical evidence. When I was a barrister, that's what we relied on. We relied on historical evidence that we presented to a jury. It was things that had happened in the past. They weren't there. Every time a jury brings back a verdict, it's a step of faith based on evidence. And I myself could not be a Christian if I didn't believe that there was evidence. I couldn't just take a blind leap of faith. For me, faith in Jesus is a step of faith based on good historical evidence. Why start with Jesus, you might say? I didn't even believe there was a God. But I came to believe in God through Jesus, because the resurrection of Jesus strongly suggests that this world has a creator, and that that creator is to be seen in terms of, through the lens of, Jesus.
Jesus of Nazareth is believed to have walked these streets around 2,000 years ago. But is there any evidence that he even existed?
Well, there's actually quite a lot of evidence. No serious historian would deny that Jesus existed. The Roman historians Tacitus and Suetonius wrote about Jesus, as did the first century Jewish historian Josephus. He described him as Jesus, a doer of wonderful works. And then he goes on to describe his crucifixion and alleged resurrection.
So there's evidence outside of the New Testament for the existence of Jesus, but most of the evidence comes from inside the New Testament. And sometimes people say, well, the New Testament was written such a long time ago. How do we know what was written down hasn't been changed over the years? Well, the answer is that we do know because of a science called textual criticism.
Textual criticism examines the number of copies of early texts that we have available to us today. And it looks at the time gap between the original document and the earliest copy that we have. And basically, the more manuscripts we have and the earlier they are, the less doubt there's going to be about the original. So let's compare the Bible to other texts in ancient history, ones that are widely used in schools and universities. Let's look at the Greek historians Herodotus and Thucydides. They both wrote in the 5th century BC. But the earliest copy of their writings that we have dates from AD 900, and that makes a 1300-year time lapse. And even then, we only have 8 copies of these manuscripts in the first place. Or look at the Roman historian Tacitus. There's a 1,000-year gap between his book being written and our first manuscript, and we only have 20 copies. Or another classic, Caesar's Gallic War, 950 years between the book being written and our first manuscript copy. And even then, we only have 9 or 10 copies of these manuscripts. Again, with Livy's famous History of Rome, a 900-year gap between the book being written and our first manuscript, and we only have 20 copies of this. But when it comes to the New Testament, well, it's very different. The New Testament was written between about 40 and 100 AD, and we have manuscript evidence going back as early as 130 AD, and full manuscripts by 350 AD. And we have more than 5,300 Greek manuscripts, 10,000 Latin translations, and 9,300 others. So, you know, we can be pretty confident in the accuracy, the authenticity, and the integrity of the New Testament scriptures that have been passed down to us today. The remarkable thing about the Bible is there's such a short chronological distance between the events being described and our first manuscripts. So in many ways, the Bible scholars are in a very fortunate position of being able to check these things out and finding that they are much more reliable than, for example, some of the alternatives you're looking at. And as a scholar, I am more than happy to say, I trust this, I take it very, very seriously, I rely on it.
Professor F.J. A. Hort, one of the greatest scholars in the area of textual criticism, concluded that, in the variety and fullness of the evidence on which it rests, the text of the New Testament stands absolutely and unapproachably alone amongst ancient prose writings. And no secular historian would disagree with that conclusion.
So we know from evidence outside and inside the New Testament that Jesus existed. But who was he? Well, we know that he was fully human, He had a human body. He ate, he drank, he sweated, he got tired, he suffered pain. And he had human emotions, love, joy, sadness, and human experiences. He had the experience of growing up in a family, of education, of having a job, of being tempted. And he experienced bereavement and suffering and torture and even death.
Many today would say, okay, he was a human being, but only a human being. Maybe he was a great religious teacher, but no more than that. Others would say he was much more than that.
Bono, the lead singer of the band U2, has said, I don't think you're led off easily by saying he was a great thinker or philosopher, because actually he went around saying he was the Messiah. That's why he was crucified. He was crucified because he said he was the Son of God. So he either, in my view, was the Son of God, or he was nuts. And I find it hard to accept that all the millions and millions of lives, half the earth, for nearly 2,000 years, have felt their lives touched and inspired by some nutter. I don't believe it. He went on to say, I believe that Jesus was the Son of God.
What evidence is there to suggest that Jesus was more than just a great religious teacher? There are two parts to this argument. The first is, what did Jesus think about himself? Because if Jesus didn't think he was God, that's the end of the argument. But if he did, the second part of the argument is, was he right? So, what did Jesus say about himself? First piece of evidence is the fact that his teaching was centered on himself. Most great religious teachers point away from themselves. They say, don't look at me, look at God. Jesus, who personified humility in pointing people to God, pointed to himself. He said, look at me, come to me. We've talked about this search for meaning and purpose, that feeling of like a spiritual hunger that other things don't quite satisfy. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. I'm the one who can satisfy that spiritual hunger. Addiction is a major problem in our society. Jesus said, if the Son, in other words, if he himself sets you free, you will be free indeed. Then there's all the stuff we carry around, worry, anxiety, guilt, fear. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. He said, if you receive me, you receive God. If you welcome me, you welcome God. If you've seen me, you've seen God.
Forgiveness is right at the heart of Christianity. Jesus went up to people and said, your sins are forgiven. Now, if someone sins against you, then you can forgive them, but you can't just walk up to anyone and say, your sins are forgiven. When Jesus said that, the lawyers said, who could forgive sins but God alone? But Jesus claimed to be able to do that. In fact, Jesus said that he came to give his life so that people could be forgiven.
One of the most direct claims Jesus made is recorded in John's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 30. Jesus said, I and the Father are one. Now, making a claim like this was seen by the religious leaders to be blasphemy. It's tantamount to a claim to be God, and it was punishable by death by stoning. People picked up stones to stone him. Then Jesus said to them, I've shown you many great miracles from the Father. For which of these do you stone me? We're not stoning you for any of these, they replied, but for blasphemy, because you, a mere human being, claim to be God.
I think when you look at all the evidence, it's clear that Jesus did make that claim. It is an astonishing claim. And a claim like that needs to be tested. If you think about it, there are only three possibilities. It was not true, and Jesus knew perfectly well it wasn't true, in which case he was a fraud. Or it was not true, and he simply didn't realize it. He genuinely thought he was the Son of God, in which case he was deluded. I think we'd say he was insane. But logically, there is only one other possibility, and that is, it's true, he was telling the truth. C.S. Lewis, Cambridge professor, best known as the author of the Chronicles of Narnia, he put it like this. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He'd either be insane or else he'd be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else insane or something worse. But let's not come up with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He hasn't left that open to us. He didn't intend to.
So was Jesus right in what he said about himself? What evidence is there to support his claims? Well, the first piece of evidence is his teaching. Much of the New Testament records numerous occasions where crowds gather to hear Jesus teach.
And on one occasion, on a mountain like this, more than 5,000 people gathered to listen to the teaching of Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount has been widely acknowledged amongst the greatest teaching of all time. Jesus' teaching has been the foundation of our entire civilization. Many of our laws were originally founded on Jesus' teaching.
Love your neighbor as yourself. Do to others as you would have them do to you. And then this, totally revolutionary. Love your enemies.
In fact, we've advanced in every field of science and technology, yet in 2,000 years, no one has ever improved on the moral teachings of Jesus. They are the greatest words ever spoken. They're the kind of words you might expect God to speak. Another thing that marked Jesus' life was his love for the marginalized, feeding the hungry, healing the sick. His character has impressed millions who wouldn't call themselves Christians. Time magazine called him the most persistent symbol of purity, selflessness, and love in the history of Western humanity. He was a person in whom even his enemies could find no fault, and whose friends said that he was without sin. It's been said that our character is truly tested when we're under pressure or in pain. And when Jesus was being tortured, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing."
Another piece of evidence is his fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. No one else in history has had a whole collection of books written about them before they were born. Jesus fulfilled over 300 Old Testament prophecies, 29 of them in a single day. Of course, it could be suggested he was a kind of clever con man who set out deliberately to deceive people. He read all these prophecies and he thought, right, I'm going to go through and I'm going to fulfill them all in my life. The difficulty with that theory is that, first of all, the sheer number of them. And then the fact that, humanly speaking, he had no control over many of these things. There were prophecies about the exact manner of his death, about the place of his burial, even about the place of his birth. Clever con man would be going around and say, "Oh my goodness, I'm supposed to be born in Bethlehem. It's too late." Then the final piece of evidence, his conquest of death. The physical resurrection of Jesus is the cornerstone of Christianity. And this is relevant to every single one of us, because we're all going to die. It's the ultimate statistic. One in one die. You go to a funeral, the coffin is lowered into the ground. It looks absolutely final. And it is, unless Jesus died and was buried and then was raised to life. In which case, death has been conquered. But is this just wishful thinking?
Raised from the dead. That's what I was taught. I don't know, I can't say yes or no.
Yes, I do believe that Jesus rose from the dead.
As a man of science, I think that's pretty impossible.
I believe so. Yes. Yes, I did.
I definitely don't think that Jesus rose from the dead. I don't think he did.
No. Jesus did not come back from the dead. That's ridiculous.
Well, it could be used as a metaphor, right? Could have been a drug trip.
Yeah, of course he did. I do believe in that, 100%.
Just the relationship that I have with him is proof enough.
I'm not sure, I haven't looked that up. I don't know.
There are four pieces of evidence for the resurrection. The first is his absence from the tomb. No one has ever satisfactorily explained how Jesus' body was absent from the tomb that first Easter day. People have come up with all kinds of explanations. For example, maybe the authorities stole the body. Well, in that case, why didn't they produce it when people started saying that he'd risen from the dead? Or perhaps the robbers stole the body.
But when the disciples heard that Jesus had been seen, they ran to the tomb, and they found that the tomb was not empty. Inside the tomb were the grave clothes that Jesus had been wrapped in.
The only valuable thing that a robber might have taken was still there. The grave clothes had collapsed like a caterpillar's cocoon when a butterfly has emerged. And the piece that had been around Jesus' head had been folded up and put in a different place. And when they saw that, they believed. The second was his presence with the disciples. Jesus was seen on more than 11 occasions, on one occasion by a group of around 500 people. People say, well, it could have been a hallucination. Well, hallucination does happen among highly strung, very nervous, or highly imaginative people, or people who are sick or are on drugs. But the disciples don't fit any of those categories. They were cynics like Thomas. There were tough fishermen. There were tax collectors, and tax collectors do not hallucinate.
The third piece of evidence is the transformation that we see in the disciples. Here was a group of people who were disillusioned, despairing that their leader had died. And then suddenly they were transformed. They started saying, we've seen Jesus, he's really alive. And they went around telling everybody. Later on, practically all of them were killed, crucified, tortured, beheaded because of what they believed. And if they were deceiving people, all they had to do was say, no, it's not actually true. But they never said that because they knew it was true. It had totally transformed their lives. And as a result, this extraordinary movement swept around the whole known world. And it's a movement without precedent in the history of humanity. And fourth, it's still happening today.
There are now over 2.3 billion Christians around the world, of every ethnicity, continent, nationality, economic, social, and intellectual background. They all speak of this encounter with the risen Jesus Christ.
So what are we to make of Jesus? It seems to me clear that Jesus really did claim to be a man whose identity was God. And when we look at the evidence of his teaching, his life, his character, his fulfillment of prophecy, his resurrection, to say he was insane or a fraud seems to me absurd, illogical, actually unbelievable. On the other hand, it provides the strongest possible supporting evidence that what Jesus said about himself was true. And when I looked at the evidence, when I read the New Testament, I came to the conclusion it is true. I didn't want to become a Christian because I thought if I became a Christian, life would be totally miserable from that moment onward. So I tried to put it off. I thought I'll put off becoming a Christian to my deathbed. And then I realized that would not be intellectually honest. So very reluctantly, I kind of said, okay, yes. And at that moment, I can still remember that moment so clearly. It dropped from here, from my head, being convinced it was true, to here in my heart, having an experience of a relationship with Jesus. And finding what I guess looking back, unconsciously, I'd been searching for all my life. Something that provided ultimate meaning and purpose to my life. It was the very last place on earth that I expected to find it. But at that moment, I found that what Jesus said was true. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and life in all its fullness. It really is true that God has revealed himself in Jesus. Jesus really is who he claimed to be. Jesus really did rise from the dead. There is hope beyond this life. There is hope for this life. Right now, in this life, in an encounter with Jesus, we find life and life in all its fullness.